Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today, continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about MLOps with MLflow, and speaking about projects, we will look at dockerizing the environments today. So, let me refresh a little bit what we are doing. MLflow projects is just a convention to organize our code. We already record two videos about that. It's just a way again to organize our code to define what we need or what anybody need to run the code we are developing in another environment. This means that we pass or we wrap everything in what is defined or known in MLflow projects, and this is not only the code, it's also some metadata and configuration files which allow to other teams or to run the software without our intervention. In this metadata, in this additional or configuration files, we define exactly what the software need to run in another environment, meaning that we specify the entry points, how the software is organized, and which kind of environment in terms of the, this case, Python packages and Python version the software needs to run, and other dependencies, obviously. So this is essentially materialized in two files. We are going to go directly to the project. I have created this new folder in the MLflow pipeline repository. Later on, I will push the latest changes and also put on the video description the link to the repository. Is public, so you can take a look later on, and also to the readmes with the all the documentation that we had there. And then on, there is essentially two files in our projects which define, first of all, the project itself, what the name, the environment. Let's do this. This is the ML project file from the for the video part one of this series. And then you provide the name of the project, you define an environment. It can be Conda, Python environment, can be a Docker, can be Kubernetes, which is an extension of what you are going to do today in Docker. And it can be these three mainly. And then you also define entry points. It can be one or multiple entry points. Let's take the entry points essentially is a command. They have a directive command. This under main. You essentially define the command in the command the Python script that you that this component will run. And the parameters they have. Also, as you can see here, we define the parameters for that specific command. If you look at other components, for example, this one which contains multiple, you can see here that the different entry points, there is a main, which is going to be the controller, if you want to say that, and the different subcomponents, which at also the command parameters and so on and so forth. So this is the main definition of your project, what the project is doing, how you have to call it, and where you are going to run it, in this case in a Conda environment, and then obviously it's pointing to a file, conda.yaml, which you have here, and in the conda.yaml you have defined the name of the Conda environment, the channels to look for the Python packages, the Conda dependencies and PIP dependencies case that you have. So with these two files, minimally these two files, you define your project, and again, it can be as much complicated as you want. Then you have the MLflow infrastructure. You need to how to say, to provide as well Emberflow infrastructure to register whatever the, your artifacts, your metrics, the logs of the experiment, etc., etc. Where is can be this infrastructure? Well, if you watch the videos I published on the channel before, it can be local. It can be as well the tracking server and the artifact directory can be everything in local. It can be the tracking server in a database running in Docker, as we have here in local. This is also a video in the channel. Set up all the Emberflow infrastructure in a in Docker containers and running in local. It can be Databricks. It can be or the combination, but mostly is the Dockers running in Kubernetes or in local. Databricks, which is probably the most used and local for this well, personal projects that you may want to do, because yeah, obviously local doesn't scale to projects that are enterprise projects. Obviously it needs to be something like Docker's Emberflow running in Kubernetes with persistent volumes to keep the artifacts and the metadata, or using it in a Databricks workspace. Today what we will do is create the components in local. These components are running in Docker containers. This you can extrapolate this to run it in the cloud. It's essentially the same. You just need to execute the command in instead to do it in local, you can do it on the cloud. Just you need to have access to the Docker repository in the cloud, the container registry in Azure, for example, and have access to run that Docker, and also have configured Emberflow tracking server to log the artifacts and metrics in case that you don't want to log it in local. When you don't specify a tracking URI like Emberflow or a URL, everything is keeping it local, and then on depending what is your environment, well, this solution is not scalable. It's not meaning that it's not gonna work, but yeah, it's not recommendable, or it's not advisable to do it that way. So in the case that that you want to create Docker containers to run your components in projects, in ML projects, you just need to obviously create a Docker. And to create a Docker, you need to create a Docker file. Here is gonna be quite simple. This is the seed, the beginning of the final video we will do in that in that project, where we will run the same in Kubernetes. But I need to set up this again, still the Kubernetes infrastructure, in order to deploy the container to the Docker infrastructure. And then what you need is pretty simple. You just need to define an image, the software that you need to run the software inside the Docker, and potentially here you use, we copy the data as well, but this is something that can be as well done programmatically. You can download the file via HTTP or connect to a blob storage or a bucket, whatever, and retrieve the data as we did on the initial project. If you look at the initial project, we just simply download the file from internet and we start our pipeline. So you can do the same as well here. Yeah, to make it simple, we just simply copy as well the one quality dataset, which is well known dataset for regression problems, and the software which essentially is just a Python script. The rest are the libraries we need to run this the content of train.py. Train.py is essentially is very simple file. We just import the libraries we need. We are going to use scikit-learn, elastic-neck, regression, supervised regression algorithm, calculate metrics, we receive the arguments, alpha and L1 ratio, we parse the arguments, we open the file, the data frame, we split it, and we just fit the model inside a MLflow experiment. And based on prediction, we detect data sets, calculate the metrics, print it to the console, and log to MLflow the metrics and model. And then for our ML project, we are just providing a name to our project. You say that we are going to use Docker environment. The image that we are going to use this one, MLflow Docker example, and our entry point. Our entry point is essentially the main, and it's going to be the execution of the command Python train. It can contain these two parameters, and as you can see here, if you don't expect, you had alpha, you just say it's a float, and L1 underscore ratio is a float as well and had a default value. And in our Dockerfile we see, and we don't need anything more. If there is nothing in the Docker ignore, so everything that we have here, it will be copy to the Docker file. Well, essentially no, sorry, it will be copy only the train.py and the wine hyperquality.csv file, which is the dataset. Now we need to build the Docker. To build the Docker, you just execute Docker build the hyperhyper pool. This is going to download from Docker Hub this image, then on hyperhappen rm. This is going to remove all the existing images with the same name that you will write down now in memory. So it is something running with the same name, it will be removed. And then on hyphen f, the file, Docker file in this case, we are in the directory Docker, pipeline Docker. We had our Docker file, and then on hyper t is the name of the MLflow Docker example. We will see latest, and we provide the scope. Where the software is located, meaning that I'm specifying that means the current directory. The current directory is Docker, so the current scope of for Docker to search the software or the files to copy inside the container is this folder. So you can see in this folder in Docker we have train and we have wine quality. You just write Docker build and just starting to create the Docker. As I already have it, you know that Docker is quite clever. If you already had and is catching the layers that it's building. Per action, every action create a layer. You have here four actions, and these four actions come in the where is Docker file. Exactly, we have four actions. Not all the directives means an action, but in this case, yes, we have four steps. And if you don't change anything, it will not. Let's include here scikit-learn, numpy, pandas. I don't know, Faker. Let's install this. We don't need it, but I just wanted to show you how it works. Now we change the content. So this is done. You see the image is the same. Now this step has changed. It will recreate it, and from here all the rest will be created again. So I will stop after this is done, and then we continue. Okay, that's done. We have created the Docker, and now to run the image. So this probably has created here in our images. We have here plenty of previous images, but here we had our Docker example you just created moments ago, 2 minutes ago. And let's return to the container now to run the project. You had here before I forget, as we are going to run the project using Databricks, you will need to set up three parameters. First of all, the MFlow tracking URI. Which had to be defined equal Databricks. Let me find out where we had this here. So in the documentation in the README, you have here how to do this. You need to export. If you are working in Unix, in Linux, you just export the variable equal Databricks, your host in Databricks. I will show you now how to get that. So your URL, this is the URL of your workspace. We are working in Microsoft Azure. So if you are working in Google or in Amazon, this URL is going to change. And the latest variable is the token. Just go to Settings, Developer, Access Token, Manage, Generate New Token, provide a comment, lifetime, zero means permanent, caducity, and here an integer, the number of days that you specify a lifetime. Generated, I don't know what's going on. Exactly, generated. You generate a token and write it down because you will not see it again. And I will use the one I have already created. And you specified in the variable Databricks token your token. Then, if you are working in Windows, set up the same in the environmental variables. And restart yourself just to take to the cell, get the latest variables or values of these variables, and to run the project to work. Let's go to our here. I had as well in the README on Dockers, you have the command, and I will explain now what is doing here. So Python hyperm mflow, we are just running the library Python mflow run. It's a mflow run. That means that is in this folder Docker, it is not in this folder. You have to put the path. It had to be the ml project file. Then on parameters that we will say to the definition of your ML project, here alpha, we need to send it, and L1 ratio, it will take the default value. Hyper experiment name, we are pointing to an experiment name in Databricks. We are going to write it down a new one. And the run name is, we are providing as well a name to this run. inside this experiment. Look at if you are logging in Databricks, regardless the provider, you will see that you have to specify slash users slash the email that you are using to log in into Databricks, and then on slash the name of the experiment. You just run it, and then on let's check here, we will see how our image is being run inside the Docker desktop. You can see here, we can enter there, we go to the cell, you do an LSL, and you can see here the train and the wine quality. So this is our Docker. Once we finish, the Docker is gone. And we have here our values, and we can go now to Databricks, experiments, and you here see the experiment, pipelines, Docker new, Docker, the metrics, the parameters. Here is the output of the fitting our model, and here the model that we log. This what you saw here is essentially the basis of the serverless technology. When you are working with technologies like Data Factory, or I don't know which one. No, there's many how is the name of this one? Synapse, for example, works like this as well. All of these are at the end, under the hood, Docker's containers or pods in Kubernetes, which are essentially running a Azure function, for example. It has a similar approach, or in Google, APP engine or others. This is the same fundamentals, the same approach. You just have a Docker with some software, and you are just, in this case, we run it. Then we had to lose some time after we run the Docker, but once the Docker is run, you have sent some parameters, some information, and can be some just pointers to files in the lake or parameters for your algorithm or whatever. And then on the software the container run the software inside the container, the software that you copied inside, and provide an outcome. In this case, the outcome is the what we log in MLflow, but it can be as well something that you push to a messaging server, something that you push to a database, something that you push to another container, something that you push to the lake, whatever. It's exactly the same, but you have a component which make a purpose, and it's running in a container. Sometimes some words is impossible for me to pronounce. You had a logic that is running in a container. You receive it had an input interface and an output interface. This is essentially the concept of serverless, and this is something. It's exactly the same as what you saw here. We had the component running locally, but this is how to say, doesn't really matter. You can run this component in the cloud, in Amazon, in Google, whatever. This is a Docker, and then you just need to have a Docker infrastructure, a container infrastructure, run this Docker, and you know that the Docker had an interface, input interface. It doesn't have an output interface in this. Well, the output interface is the connection that the container had, or the component had, with the MLflow, where we are logging everything that the Docker is doing inside. And as I said, this can be as complex as you want. Here, it can be this project can be multiple steps, like you have here in multiple step workflow. You have another example, and it can be as well something like that. I will create as well something. I will do this in Docker because these components are how to say that Spark components. They are running PySpark. It's a little bit more complex to run it in your local environment, but well, I will create something to do it. To do this as well in a container. Well, what I wanted to show, tell you is that it can be just a single step, but it can be as well multiple steps. Usually when you have multiple steps, you have a main, which is the coordinator, the component which coordinates the sequence of the other ones. And then on this is your entry point, your main entry point, the one that you expose as input, and this is again governing the activity of the other ones. So again, as you can see, this is pretty flexible. It's not only flexible in terms of the where, how you can define your environments and how you define it, where you run your components, also where you are logging the output of your components. In this case, we are logging everything into Emerflow, which is essentially one of the technologies more used to leverage the machine learning lifecycle. And well, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like it and you find it interesting and useful for your job or your training. And in case of that, just give me a like. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends and colleagues in order to help me to promote the channel. And yeah, that's all. Thank you very much. See you soon.